Do a set list.
Sorry.
That's okay.
Good evening, everybody. Yeah. Welcome to East Shore Live. I'm delighted to have you here this evening. Thank you so much. I'm John Schmay. I'm the Artistic Director for East Shore Live. This is our regular program of arts and entertainment for our community. This is our third show of our four-show season. The history of Latin jazz, we're going to have a lot of fun tonight. We'll tell you all about that as we go. Our next show is April 21st, featuring Airplane Barnes. Is it just me? June 21st. It said April 21st on the page, so that's what I get. Okay, I walked over, yeah, April 21st, that's it. Yeah. Well, I hope you were there. It was really amazing. June 21st. Airplane Barnes will be here with his one-man show, which is going to be fantastic. He's going to talk about his whole history of coming of age as a musician and human being. And I know I'm going to be here, so it's going to be really fun. So come to see Is It Just Me on June 21st. Tonight we have a pretty special event. This is an opportunity to hear some local area musicians, including some young folks who are playing in our horn section, and some people that really have put a lot of time into performing for you this evening. So we're very excited to really express to you the history of Latin jazz. So I'd like to introduce John Schmay. Thank you. All right. Well, we have a real special show, and I'm gonna take you on this journey together. We're gonna take this journey of discovery, of union and evolution between three major cultural trends: the Spanish and Afro-Cuban world of South America, the popular songs and dances of North America, and the African-American rhythms that infused and ultimately bonded these influences together. Latin jazz is more than a set of songs or rhythms. It's the expression of the evolution of culture in both North and South America, as experienced through music and dance. It's the celebration of the unique synthesis of people that happens in our country, naturally and somewhat inevitably, as we all sing, dance, and grow together. Latin musical influences flowed up, like many other things, into the U.S. from Cuba, Haiti, and other countries into New Orleans. In the mid-1800s, there were dance-on bands that played distinctly Caribbean music in New Orleans. As jazz music began to develop in New Orleans in the early 1900s, the jazz composers like Jelly Roll Morton were referring already in the 1900s to the Spanish tinge in jazz music. In fact, Morton even went so far as to say, "If you can't manage to put a tinge of Spanish in your tunes, you will never be able to get the right seasoning, as I call it, for jazz." The important thing to point out is that Afro-Cuban and Afro-American music were united from the outset of the jazz experience. In fact, the earliest recorded blues, the St. Louis Blues, begins with a tango based on a Cuban dance known as the habanera or conga danza. Writing about the first time St. Louis Blues was played, which was 1914, W.C. Handy, the composer, said, When St. Louis Blues was written, the tango was in vogue. I tricked the dancers by interaging the tango introduction, breaking abruptly into a low-down blues. My eyes swept the floor anxiously. Then suddenly I saw lightning strike. The dancers seemed electrified. Something within them suddenly came to life, an instinct that wanted so much to live, to fling its arms to spread joy, took them by the heels. Well, feel free to fling your arms in joy, should you feel so inclined, as we perform St. Louis Blues. And listen for that tango that peeks in and out of this very, very early blues. Well, the rumba first came to the United States via these dance bands from Cuba. It became a hugely popular phenomenon in the early 1930s, and jazz musicians like Louis Armstrong and Duke Ellington jumped right on board to ride that wave. Duke brought a Puerto Rican trombonist, Juan Tizol, into his band in 1929, and he stayed for 15 years. The two of them collaborated on the now classic tune, Caravan, in 1932. Now, Caravan was marketed as a Middle Eastern type of jazz tune, but it actually sat on top of a Cuban rumba. At this point then, jazz rhythms were kind of an auxiliary part of the jazz language, a little spice in the stew, as it were, but not at the heart of the new Latin jazz music. Caravan has become a staple, nonetheless, in the jazz repertoire and has been widely recorded to this day. And we'll present it now featuring Audrey Stangland, our trombonist. Let us climb aboard the Caravan from 1932.
Thank you.
Foggy, and we'll flash. All right. So, the bolero is a slow dance style with a long lineage starting in Spain and running to America through Cuba and Mexico. This elegant slow style served as the background to the most sung and recorded song in Mexican history, Bésame Mucho. We've all heard that. This classic was first recorded in 1940 and has served as a major pop, Latin, jazz crossover, highlighting another subgenre of Latin jazz as a highly popular dance and song style, not just an instrumental genre. Bésame Mucho has been covered by everyone from Placido Domingo to the Beatles, and from Herb Alpert to Michael Bublé. The composer was Consuelo Vélez Suárez, who wrote Bésame Mucho, which means kiss me a lot in Spanish, even though she at the time had never been kissed. Well, she sure had an active and accurate imagination, as we will hear now, as our vocalist, Susanna Fuller, sings the original lyrics. Now, those of you who are not bilingual will just have to use your imagination as to when and how all this kissing takes place. Bésame Mucho.
Bésame mucho. Thank you.
Bassist Al McKibben, who was in the band and a major contributor to this style, he writes, "When we started to play things with a Latin flavor in Dizzy's band, some kind of magic happened. Things like Lake Tunisia, they were marvelous with the conga drum. And when we played Manteca at the Apollo Theater, I thought the balcony was going to fall off the hinges because John Pozzo was so great." In 1947, Pozzo and Gillespie wrote Manteca, a huge hit for the band and the best fusion of African and Afro-Cuban jazz music to that point. By the late 1940s, bebop and Latin music became merged at clubs and dance halls throughout the New York. Imagine a show with a smoking Cuban dance band was then spelled by a bebop combo headed by Charlie Parker, and then later both bands all sit in with each other. What an evening that must have been. Latin jazz was coming of age. So now let's enjoy Dizzy Gillespie's big hit, Manteca. We're going to feature our bass player, John Kaler, to open up. Thank you. jazz artists began embracing Latin music into the 1950s, expanding the styles and compositions into a virtual kaleidoscope of combinations. Bebop artists such as Sonny Rollins and later Horace Silver would create lasting jazz Latin compositions. On the cool side, artists such as George Shearing and Cal Jader began to create a more subtle, textured performances with a gentle lyricism and simplicity within the percussive textures of Latin grooves. At the same time, Cuban and Latin musicians enjoyed their greatest popularity. Artists such as Arsenio Rodriguez, Perez Prado, and Mabel Valdez wrote a new wave of mambo mania as mambo became a highly popular dance and song style in its own right. Jazz musicians began to go down to Havana to perform, and an inverse style of jazz Latin music emerged from Cuban-centered jazz bands. Now, it's just reopened Cuba in the last few years, but back in the 40s and 50s, before Castro, Havana was a cool place to go. You went on vacation to Havana, and they had all these nightclubs, and so now all the jazz guys are coming down to Cuba and playing Latin music. So the synthesis is going back and forth and back and forth, and new Latin jazz stars emerged. Candido and Manto Santa Maria and Armando Carraza. They infused the strong percussion and conga music into many jazz and popular recordings. By this time, Latin music is really sort of already the foundation of a lot of pop, jazz, and crossover music. So the river of Latin jazz was already becoming a delta of many musical streams. By the early 1960s, Latin jazz was already a mature art form. It was 50 years old. It had new tributaries emerging from different Latin jazz styles as additional countries and cultures began to fuse their styles into the mix. The bossa nova style emerged in Brazil as a dance and popular form in its own right. But when jazz artists like Dizzy Gillespie and Herbie Mann toured down in Brazil in the 60s, a whole new approach to Latin jazz began to evolve. Bossa nova and samba had a gentler approach to music, more lyrical and simple, with great melodies and clear harmonies to improvise on. At the center of the emergence of Brazilian styles was the composer Antonio Carlos Jobim, who practically invented the Brazilian jazz tune. More than a dozen of his compositions are strong standards that all jazz musicians know to this day. His tunes serve as the fuel for many jazz musicians to now reinvent themselves through the bossa nova style. And foremost among them was the saxophonist Stan Getz. Stan Getz's recordings with Gilberto and Gilberto's vocalist wife, Astrud, became wildly popular. They were at the center of a whole bossa samba craze that practically engulfed every major jazz performer in the 60s. If you look at all these album covers, every jazz performer had to have their bossa album, you know, even if they didn't know what they were doing. So, that's what it was. But here to end our first set, actually not our first set, we're going to have one more tune after this, but here to show the bossa nova, we're going to feature Susanna on one of the most popular tunes from that period. Three guesses and the first two don't count. If you haven't heard The Girl from Ipanema, you've probably never been in an elevator or a dentist's office. But that notwithstanding, it remains a lovely, well-constructed Gilberto composition. The samba treatment and jazz approach shows how any material can become Latin jazz when the right feeling is applied. So let's enjoy Susanna singing about the boy from Ipanema. Thank you. that song a little differently now when you're waiting in the dentist's office. I'd like to take a second to introduce this fine ensemble that's worked hard to bring this music to you tonight. There's a whole mix of different folks, some players that are new, some players that know each other in various combinations, and they've all really been exciting and a lot of fun to play with. So I'll start from left to right. Someone that we just began to play with that we really enjoy is a Central Washington student just about to get her degree. Is that true? In a year? Yes. It's Audrey Stanglin on trombone. The next player is a fine multi-instrumentalist, also a Central graduate, now performing and playing professionally in the area. That's what he's doing. He could walk here. He lives over by a T-Mobile. So it's fantastic that he sort of walked into the gig tonight. It's Brian Lawrence on saxophone. Our next saxophone player stepped in at the last minute. We had Ryan McKnight on the docket, and he's on your program. And the jazz department at Central decided to have a jazz festival, and they told him about it Tuesday. Maybe they did last week. He thought about it on Tuesday. So Will stepped in, and I think he's doing a great job on really short notice. Let's give it up for Will Flax. When we first met this trumpet player playing at Bukhara's Indian Restaurant down on Front Street. You ever been down there? They have great food. So he came and sat in with our band, and it's been an opportunity to play with him here on a concert setting. And we're not serving Indian food, but we are serving Michael Crone tonight. Let's give it up. And the core of the Cascade Jazz Ensemble is the next four musicians, including myself. Myself and the three other musicians I'm going to introduce. Let's give it up to our bass player, John Kaler. As you can tell, just an outstanding vocal performer and capable of performing a lot of styles. And I've never seen her Latin get up before. That's pretty snazzy. She's doing hot saucy tonight. It's Susanna Fuller. When she goes walking, everybody says, ah. The following musician founded Cascade Jazz with me in 2000. We're going to be almost 20 years together playing music. This is my sidekick and partner, Brian Kamarik on drums. Great, you guys are up for it tonight. That's awesome. Now, you cannot play this music without a stud of Latin percussionist. It is not authentic music until you have Ernesto Pallanco on the percussion.
Filipino!
A Filipino Latin percussionist in Belgium. There you go. How multicultural can you get? So, you're going to hear more from Ernesto in the second set. We're going to finish our first set. We're going to have a 15-minute intermission, and we're going to hold right to it. So, when you hear us playing, you know we're playing. So, the next tune is by Sonny Rollins. It's a beautiful tune called St. Thomas. Sonny Rollins was, and still is, in his 80s, performing all over the world as one of the major saxophone innovators in jazz history. He was at the center of the bebop tornado in the early 50s, but as he expanded his style, he began incorporating all kinds of musical styles into his albums, including this folk tune we're about to hear from the Virgin Islands. Now, Sonny Rollins is from Trinidad, culture, and his mother sang this song to him. It was called the Lincolnshire Poacher, but it was turned into a Caribbean melody, and it was transformed by Sonny Rollins, again, into the jazz tune of St. Thomas. It's a nod to the many diverse cultures and beats here at Calypso that have broadened the Latin jazz river into many tributaries. Now we're going to challenge the horn section to trade choruses, fours, twos, and ones.
Hey!
That's it. We haven't done it yet. Don't say nothing. We rehearsed this earlier. So it's going to go well. It's going to be fun. You're going to enjoy St. Thomas.
Thank you.
Is that what you go?
Hey!
Talk it over, and we'll see you in 15 minutes.
Thank you.
I know.
Yeah, that's me. Thank you.
All right. Now back to the second half.
Let's keep talking about the history of Latin jazz. We left off around 1960, right? So a major contributor to the evolution of Latin jazz was Mongo Santamaria. He was a masterful conga player in Cal Jayer's band in the late 50s. And he started his own series of Latin bands, and he wrote many tunes based on African Yoruba rhythms, which came through Cuba. And there was really a cycle of energy that came from the Yoruba rhythms into Cuba and then back into the United States by way of the jazz bands. And this song, Afro Blue, was one of his signature compositions. The song is based on a syncopated 3-beat pattern, which is layered in multiple parts. So it's got this Afro-Cuban feel, but it's got a blues feel on top for the scales. So we're gonna let the percussionist hold court for this one, with a bit of simple flute over the top, as really, yet just another percussion instrument. In fact, our master percussionist, Ernesto Pagliano, will introduce a special percussion instrument to lead us off.
And this is the Afro-Peruvian cajon. Yeah. I'll do a little percussion interlude, then I'll break into the rhythm that we're going to discuss.
Thank you.
No survey of Latin jazz would be complete without acknowledging the wide range of popular songs and styles that attend its history. The tango, rumba, mambo, bossa, and other dance crazes, these ran alongside other dance forms and jazz that emerged from most of the early 20th century. Latin music is inherently dance music, right? I mean, when merged with jazz improvisation, one can hear the best of both worlds. It's an unbeatable combination. Lighter versions of May jazz numbers were big hits in popular music. We celebrate the commercial success of Latin jazz now with Sway, a popular mambo tune I'm sure many of you know. It's been recorded by everyone from Dean Martin to the Pussycat Dolls. As the music says, when marimba music starts to play, dance with me, make me sway. Like a lazy ocean hugs the shore, hold me close, sway me more.
Get a sleep sometime.
Thank you.
won't make it, Grace. We gotta get out of here. Are we gonna help us break down afterwards? Yeah. Okay. I got my musician hat on. I'm just gonna indulge. Here we go. All right. The next type of music we have to have covered is called salsa. Salsa music. It's based on a very old dance form called the son. It's a Cuban dance form. Actually, itself, a fusion of Spanish and Afro-Cuban styles. It arose in popularity in New York by way of Cuba and Puerto Rico in the 1970s. It continues to this day. There's salsa bands everywhere. You can go to Yakima and hear some amazing salsa. I mean, this music is really just prevalent, even all over Washington State. Now, salsa relies on a repeating piano figure, a montuno. So you get to just keep that going like a machine, and then you add in the percussion and the bass lines on top of it, and the strong horn figures over the top. So this thing really gets going like a machine, right? So we've got all those ingredients present here tonight. So let's have fun with a little salsa song that I wrote in the early 80s entitled Salsa Song. I don't get points for creativity, do I? Let's go. Thank you. just had a, you go, da-do-da-do-da-da. You'll be hearing that tomorrow morning. You're going to get up and go, da-do-da-do-da-da. Next Thursday, you're going to wish it was out of your head. All right, we're going to have some fun with a real famous tune that might rightfully be known as the national anthem of Latin music, if only because it's been played in so many contexts, from its origin as cha-cha music in the Chancillo, its parent song, to the many jazz-oriented versions by Tito Puente, to the Carlos Santana song that made it famous. The lyrics say it all. They're in your program if you want to sing along. Oye, como va? Listen how it goes. Mi ritmo, my rhythm. Bueno para gozar, it's good for having fun. Mulata, baby.
Hey.
Here we go.
Santana, right?
Yeah.
Tito Puente.
Yeah.
Si, si. Puente, not Puentes.
Yeah.
Can't tell the score without a program. You want to count us off, Russell?
Yes.
Yeah. Get some boy with your como va. All right. We're in the home stretch. Just got a couple tunes left. So Latin rhythms have merged so deeply into our culture that we often don't even know how deeply they run. Tom Waits, who's like a kind of a pop singer known as the writer of rye, alcohol, lady, rock ballads. He's an unlikely source for a tango. But Temptation is a solid tango. Although Tom can't avoid taking us right back to the bar stool with his own brand of smoky wit as he sings, rusted brandy in a diamond glass. Everything is made from dreams. Time is made from honey, slow and sweet. Only the fools know what it means. Temptation is in the chromium. So check this out. We're going to feature Michael Crumb on trumpet with Temptation.
I think this is
know, Chick Corea is one of the most influential modern jazz pianists in history. His modern jazz style has been the center of sophisticated modern jazz music since he emerged with Miles Davis Group in the 1960s. And he became a jazz rock guy in the 70s and returned to Forever and really sort of created a whole modern jazz thing. Yeah, I grew up with that too. But Chick's roots are in Spanish culture and music. His father ran a Spanish dance band in Chelsea, Massachusetts. And Chick's roots included a stint with Mongo Santa Maria, remember Afro Blue? And his own bands emerged in the 1970s. He always had a Latin influence. And he had Brazilian percussionist Ayrton Moreira, as well as his vocalist wife, Flora Perim, in many of his early recordings. And songs with titles like Spain and La Fiesta were staples of the early Korea bands. So now we're going to play an extended arrangement of this song featuring just about everybody. So it's been a distinct pleasure to take this journey together. You've been a really, really attentive and fun audience. So we're going to finish tonight with La Fiesta.
Yeah, that one song.
I know it's late. We're all going to hustle out of here. Everybody's going to take your table and take it out the door. No, just kidding. Okay, we do have one more smoking little tune. And we should get on with it really quickly. This is a great tune written by a very strange young hippie in the 50s named Eden Abez, who lived near the Hollywood sign in L.A. And he walked up to Nat King Cole at the Hollywood Bowl and handed him this song and said, "This will be your biggest hit." Nat King Cole said, "Really?" It was Nature Boy. It was Nat King Cole's biggest hit. We're going to do it now featuring Susanna and the band, Nature Boy. Thank you very much for all your love and attention.
Yeah.
On the floor, check your car keys, we got some, or tell us what car it is so we can have it.